Right, now I'm going to start looking at the use of Excel with this data set. We've got a data set here which is based on a new product development team having shades of flavour of long established ice cream. They organised a sensory panel with 10 people who tasted both samples. Participants displayed a flavour of 0, they didn't like it, to 20, they loved it. Later on, we'll look at the statistical validity of these data. But for now, what we want to do is look at some formatting and graphing options. So in terms of formatting, we'll notice up here it's got all flavour. It appears up here, you can see the whole thing, but we can't see it down here. We can be sort of crude and we can just grab that column across to make it a bit bigger. That's not probably the best plan. So what I'm going to do is click on the reverse arrow. We can't actually see the reverse arrow, so I'll pull that down a little bit. Click on the reverse arrow, take it back to where it was. And I'm going to select these two cells here. Right, so now what I'm going to do is right click, and I'm going to go to Format Cells. Now in Alignment, which is already picked, we can set it to align the cell contents to the top, and we can tell it to wrap text. So when we look at it now, we can see the cell is wrapped, and it's put everything so we can see it. It's not quite right. It'd be nice if we had all these centered. So again, what we do is we select all of these data. In this case, we simply go to here. We could have gone to right-click Format Text as well, but simply just do Center from here. Actually, that's not bad. It's looking a bit nicer. We can make it look better by adding some grid lines. So again, we just go up to here, and there's a number of options here. In this case, it's set for all borders. Click on this, and all borders appear. Okay, so we've got some nicely formatted data here. The next thing we might want to do is add a couple of statistical functions to summarise the data. Now, I have this thing where I like to have a MD column at the left-hand side. You don't need this, it's just me. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to push this across. So again, I've selected these MD cells here. I'm going to right-click, and I'm going to click on Insert. Shift cells right, that's what we want, and it moves the cells across. Okay, so I've got a bit of room here now. And I'm going to do the average. Hope if I could spell. Average of the mean, if you will. And also something called the standard deviation, which I'm going to summarise as STDEV. That's just a measure of how much the data varies within itself, based on the average. Okay, so we can calculate this by summing them up and dividing them by the number of samples, but we can just use an Excel function. You access Excel functions by clicking the arrow and then starting to type. So average, there's a number of things you can hear which we may look at a bit later on, but for now it's just the average. If we go up to here, we can see average, so we put in a quote. Beg your pardon, put in a quote. Select the cells that we're interested in and close the quote. And then click on tick for OK. So it puts the average in there. It doesn't send it. Right, okay, now if we drag across, it should, in theory at any rate, correct the averages for the second column. So if we look at the first one, it's the average C16 to C15 up here, and the second one, it's D16 to D15, so that's good. Now, standard deviations are a function using similar numbers, so we might think, oh, we can drag that down, and we'll get similar numbers, but unfortunately we don't. It's average of C6 there and C15. It's C6, C7 and C16, so it's different. So I'm going to delete that and show you a little trick for the times when you want to use the same data. But not always true, but it's useful sometimes. So in this case, I'm just going to select that data and I'm going to press F4 on the keyboard. We'll notice it has the dollar signs. Now what happens now, when I pull down, we'll see it's still 15. We want to change this to STDEV. The standard deviation, STDEV, and type that in, and it adds a standard deviation. Now we can do a similar operation up here. Again, we'll select the data and then press F5 on the top row of the keyboard. For some reason that didn't work. F5, well, it's not working. Beg your pardon, it's not F5, it's F4. I should, of course, have known that. Okay, so again, it's put in the same data. We'll drag down and we'll change that into STDEV. Right, so we've got the averages and we've got the standard deviations for these two sets of data. So again, we want to do some cleaning up on these, I think. So we'll set them both to be centered. we'll add a little box around them, and maybe to make them, to highlight them a little bit, what we can do is we can go to the fill cell box and we'll put in a particular color just so that they look quite nice. So we know the calculated values rather than raw data values. It'd be nice if we had the same number of decimal points for each of these. Now, the average, I think, is probably reasonable to have one decimal place. So we'll go to format cells again, go to number, select number, then make one for the decimal places. The standard deviation, probably a good idea to have two, maybe three, but we'll have two, I think. So we go to, again, right-click, format cells, number, two decimal places, click on OK. Right, so now what we want to look at now is some graphing options. We'll look at graphing options which will help us determine the statistical validity of these samples in a second video in this series. But for now, what we want is just some basic graphs. So I'm going to select the data, including the column headings, but not selecting the calculated values. I go to insert and go to recommended charts. Now there's a number of charts it offers. Some of them are really no use, like the scatter chart. That one's not bad. We'll have a look at it in a second and talk about the things which we probably want to include in the graph. Okay, so I'm going to click on OK to get that. Right, so it's produced a nice graph. It's maybe not the best graph we could possibly have, and we'll have a look at some other alternatives in a second. One thing it doesn't have is a chart title. So what I'm going to do is just do a little bit of laziness. I'm going to copy that. Close that if you're not careful. So I'll copy it again. Go back to here. And why does it want to paste? It does want to paste. So now we've got the title in. Right, we've got a legend down here. We've got the old flavor, we've got the new flavor, but we haven't got any titles for the axes, which is a problem. Axes always need titles and sometimes need units. In this case, they don't need units. So how do we produce the axis titles? What we do is we double click on the graph, and it produces this new menu option, add chart element. But it would be really nice if we could add both axes titles in the same time, but we can't. We need to add primary horizontal first and then primary vertical second. So in primary horizontal, this would be the participant, we'll call it. That's quite useful. It's possible that we could, if we knew more about the participants, perhaps their age, perhaps their gender, we could look at whether there's any particular bias operating here. But in this case, it's just participants 1 through 10. The axis title over here is, what are we going to call it? We'll call it response. So as we discussed earlier on, if it was a low response, people didn't like it. If it was a high response, people liked it. Now, the other thing we could possibly do is if we click on either one of these, doesn't really matter which one, right-click, we can go to add data labels. So we can add the numbers. We can add the numbers to the other one. It can get a little bit confusing if you have a lot of data happening. Okay, so that's a basic graph. It's not a bad graph. It's maybe not the best way of presenting the data. So we'll have a think about other ways in which we could present the data. Okay, so we'll have a look at some other graphs which may or may not be useful. So I'm just going to move that one out of the way. Again, we select the data and we go to insert. Again, we're going to have a look at recommended charts. So we talked about the dot plots not being particularly useful. There's that one which is a clustered bar, which isn't too bad, I guess. Some people may find it a little bit confusing. Then there's that one. A stacked column, which is sort of good for looking at individual differences between people, but again, maybe doesn't really help us in terms of looking at the overall sort of approach to what we found. We wouldn't use a line chart for this. Line charts are used for things that vary continuously, for example, something that's changing over time. Again, that's a stack bar, which is the horizontal version of the one we saw a bit earlier on, and the same issues apply to it. That one would be nice if it was broken down into the two sides, but it isn't, unfortunately. And then there's one there which isn't any use at all. So if we look at all charts, we can see a range of other ones. So there's this one here, old flavour, new flavour, which shows a sort of general distribution between the two groups. You would have to do a certain amount of playing around with the various series things, which are effectively the individual participants. With pie chart, you wouldn't use a pie chart for this, and pie charts generally aren't a very good thing to use anyway. So if we go down, one of the things we might want to have a look at is a radar chart, and these are really important in this area. Okay, so we saw a radar chart a bit earlier on when we did one of the master classes. So if we click on this, click on OK, we get the radar chart in here, which gives us a nice graphical way of looking at the information. If you remember when we did the master classes on tasting, this was based also on different flavour characteristics. In this case, it does show, generally speaking, I guess that the new flavour is less successful than the old flavour. And when you look at the average, we can see that as well. The average is 11.1 compared to the average of 15.1. And I think this does help a little bit graphically. I should mention that this is the graph as it's produced. If you double click on it again, get rid of that. Excel does produce a range of different options for you, which you can sort of scroll through and decide which are appropriate, which one's the best. Some of them aren't particularly good. I don't think a black background is a very good idea. These are quite clear. Again, black background, probably evil. So you can choose which one you want. Okay, so there's a couple of options for graphing these. We'll come back to look at graphs in a little bit more detail later on. Thanks for listening.